Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our briefing on geothermal energy this afternoon. And just like the weather here in Washington, we think that geothermal also is really heating up and that we all need to do our part to truly make that the case. My name is Carol Werner. I'm the Executive Director of the Environmental and Energy Study Institute. We are delighted to be holding this briefing this afternoon prior to tomorrow's day-long meeting, providing an international geothermal showcase, and we are so glad to be doing this forum in conjunction with the Geothermal Energy Association, with whom we have long had a very strong partnership, as we feel that geothermal is such an extremely important part of our energy portfolio, that it is an area that we hope will truly grow, that it provides so many wonderful attributes and is such an important piece of how we should look at how we really truly bring forward a clean energy economy, both here in the United States as well as in so many countries across the globe. And for too long, we feel that geothermal has often been what I often refer to as a stepchild in the renewable energy family of resources and technologies. And geothermal is an extremely valuable resource that can be used in so many different ways. And of course, an area which is so important in terms of as we think about the decarbonization of our power sector, the characteristic that it brings of being baseload power. So to kick off our briefing this afternoon, I want to turn to Ryan Mulvenon, who is the policy advisor to Senator Harry Reid of Nevada. Senator Reid has been a very, very long time leader and supporter of geothermal energy. And of course, Nevada is one of our great geothermal resource states. And so Senator Reid could not be with us, but Ryan is a very able representative, and we're delighted to have you here, Ryan.
Thanks for having me. Like Carol said, I work for Senator Reid. My name is Ryan Mulvenon. I'm sorry he couldn't be here today. Geothermal energy is important to him. And my boss is known for getting right to the point, so I'm going to keep this short so we can get right to the briefing. For quite a while, the future of clean energy and geothermal energy, I think, has been a classic test of willpower. The only question is whether we would persevere to create the right investment environment for geothermal and for clean energy to thrive. And why my boss has never believed that government is the answer to every problem, at least in this case, government has to create the right conditions for businesses to invest. So real progress has been made, especially after the deal in December. But it wasn't lost on my boss that work remains to bring more investment certainty to geothermal energy. So he continues to do what he can to make sure that the right investment environment is created for clean energy and geothermal energy to thrive. And work continues on that topic to the day. Beyond those issues with a tax scope, you know, my boss continues to work to improve the way that clean energy is transmitted in this country. And he was very pleased about the expansion of the One Nevada transmission line late last year, early this year. I'm forgetting which one it was. And he continues to be engaged on funding for geothermal energy and the Forge project at the Department of Energy. So on those issues and more, I hope everyone knows that my boss's door is always open on these subjects, and we want to hear from you. And I'm confident that with the teamwork of the folks that are listening online and the people in this room, that we will have the willpower to succeed. So thanks again for inviting me, Carol, and to GEA. And with that, I'll turn it back to you.
Thanks so much, Ryan. And I think, as everyone knows, the geothermal has been very, very fortunate to have the kind of very consistent and persistent leadership coming out of Senator Reid's office for years, and really bringing people together around that and around key policy ideas and strategies. So we are now going to turn to our first panelist this afternoon. And we are deeply honored to have with us Sakari Oksanen, who is the Deputy Director General of IRENA, which is the International Renewable Energy Agency. The Deputy Director General joined IRENA in 2015 in his current role, where he is responsible for leading IRENA's programmatic work and ensuring very, very close linkages among planning, implementation, monitoring, and evaluation of all of IRENA's many, many activities across the renewable space. His career includes more than 25 years of international management experience in consulting engineering businesses, which is a very, very good background for the very important work that IRENA is about. Mr. Deputy Director General.
Thank you, Executive Director Ms. Werner. Ladies and gentlemen, I must say that coming through the town and see the beautiful city of Washington in spring and experience the trees in blossom is really a wonderful experience. And it's a pleasure to be here. And I must appreciate the opportunity to introduce International Renewable Energy Agency, our activities, and whatever, not so much, but something we have been doing on the geothermal field to this audience. So thank you. Starting from IRENA, it is an intergovernmental organization, and it has a very, very clear mandate which is written in its statute. It supports countries in their transition to sustainable energy future, and it says that the agency promotes widespread and increased adoption of all forms of renewable energy. That's our mandate. And it, of course, includes many forms: bioenergy, there is geothermal energy, ocean energy, solar energy, and wind energy. So the whole spectrum. And if I would characterize today, it's not only the energies as self, it's the whole energy system as an integrated totality that we need to consider to get the mission accomplished. A little bit about IRENA. It is a fairly young agency. It's established 5 years ago, 2011. It is headquartered in Abu Dhabi and headed by Director General Adnan Amin. We have another office in Germany, in Bonn, and that office focuses on technology, costs, and innovation. And then we have a smaller outlet in New York. It's a representation office to United Nations. Here to be noted that IRENA is not a UN agency. It is an independent intergovernmental agency established by its members. Our membership is almost nearly universal. So we have 140 states as members, including one non-state, that's European Union. And then we have 36 states under process of accession. So we have 176 governmental entities at the moment, and it is a very good achievement, and I would say it's also an acknowledgement of our work to receive or to achieve the nearly universal membership in just 5 years. If I think about our operations the focus areas of our activities, I would say that there are five groups of focus areas. One is technology. Okay, before technology, there are resources, renewable energy resources. Then there is technology. Third is technology costs. Four is policy and regulation. And five is financing. So if I look at what we do, almost everything spins around these aspects of business. And these are the elementary aspects of any energy business that is carried out by various stakeholders. And we could also say that we have three modes of influencing the global energy sector. One is to initiate discussion and contribute to the global debate on renewable energy. And in this, we pay attention on the country's commitments, their ambition level towards renewable energy, their commitments, policies, INDCs, and then the different international fora play important role. Our assembly, which gathers annually, is already developed to be one of the major global renewable energy events. And but of course, the influence continues beyond that. There are United Nations framework, there is G20 process, there is G7 process, to which we also participate, and various organizations and regional initiatives in which we are part. And then, as well, we have the bilateral engagement with our membership and different countries. Secondly, we contribute to the debate by providing information and data. And this is a very prominent part of our activities. So we provide statistics, analysis, databases, and it's freely accessible to all. It's not so very well organized yet, but I still encourage you to visit our web pages and download some of our documents. There is a rich repository of over a few hundred documents from various fields of the renewable energy world. We publish around 50 documents and knowledge products annually. Thirdly, we provide technical assistance and capacity building services, and we have created various mechanisms and with our members, especially the developing countries, either directly or through regional cooperation and various platforms. We have worked with at least 90 countries directly, and we have conducted so-called renewable readiness assessments for more than 20 countries. And one of our sort of products is renewable energy roadmap. And these kind of roadmaps have been carried out for around 10 countries. Yeah, here is a list of the sort of brand names of these various products. Our flagship report is the Rethinking Energy Remap. 2030 is a global roadmap. And then we have the national roadmaps that I mentioned, cost analysis, resource, and global atlas, which is a map-based database for renewable energy resources. As to the outreach and partnership, we interact with various mechanisms. One very interesting one is this African Clean Energy Corridor we discussed just before this panel. The idea is to interconnect Eastern Africa to Southern Africa and ultimately up to Egypt with the strong transmission links. And the benefit of this to renewable energy deployment is, of course, obvious because there are certain hotspots in Eastern Africa for especially geothermal energy. There is the Ethiopia-Kenya area where there is an abundant resource available. But there are also hydropower concentrations, thinking about countries like Zambia and again Ethiopia. So the purpose of the initiative is to be able to upscale the deployment of renewable energy so that the countries would not limit their efforts to their national needs but would consider the continental needs. And then finally to do renewable energy trading across the borders and make use of that report fully. A very important focus of our operation is also the island and island states. So we do have a lot of program for various islands. We are not a financing agency, but as I said, financing is also one of the key areas of focus because it is so important for anyone who develops renewable energy projects. We have a product which was launched just a few weeks ago called Sustainable Energy Marketplace. It is basically a platform for project developers and the financing community to meet up. So it is a meeting place. And in Eastern Africa, we have already something like 30 to 40 projects listed and a number of financing agencies and equity financiers also registered into the system. And they can meet, they can screen their financing conditions on the other hand, and then the financiers can screen the projects and pick up some and establish direct contact for further negotiations. So it is a facilitating platform. Then we have a project navigator tool, which provides templates and tools for those who are at the very initial stage of project development. So helping them to develop the project to a bankable stage. Finally, we do have a touch, even though we are an intergovernmental agency, we have a touch to the very basic level of project development through one financing facility in which we cooperate with Abu Dhabi Fund for Development. And it is granting concessional loans by the Abu Dhabi government, but basically IRENA acts as a fund manager effectively for this fund. Something like 15 projects and lending decisions to the amount of 144 million have been already granted under this facility. Regarding the geothermal development, I need to say that it is a work in progress, but we are now focusing increasingly to geothermal side. We have provided technical assistance and capacity building along the lines that I described earlier, especially to the Andes countries, Bolivia, Chile, Colombia, Ecuador, and Peru. And then the ADFD, IRENA funding facility, through that we have provided funding already to two geothermal projects. One is in Iran, capacity is 5 megawatts, and the other one is in St. Vincent and Grenadines, 10 to 15 megawatts. The project is actually in a quite early stage, but still progressing promisingly. Regarding the other tools I mentioned, Global Atlas and Project Navigator, we are currently working to include the geothermal aspect to those. So it means resources mapping on the map base, and then on the other hand, providing a credible tool for those who enter the geothermal business to develop their projects. Finally, I would like to mention the Global Geothermal Alliance, which is a new platform, and it is strongly supported by IRENA. It was launched at the COP21 in Paris last December, and at the moment the alliance is at the stage where the members are preparing the action plan. And we are very glad that the US government and also the US Geothermal Energy Association are members. And I need to say that the US government has been very active and contributed positively in setting up this alliance and helping to draft its initial action plan. The alliance has some 40 countries already signed in and 26 implementation partners, out of which 3 are industry partners, 6 academic and research institutions, and then we have a lot of development banks and funds who have become partners. The deployment of geothermal energy is on increase, but we all recognize that comparing to the potential, there is lots to be done. And the total potential, sort of installed capacity globally, around 13 gigawatts, is not a very big figure. It's a good achievement, but comparing to the potential, there is lots to be done. Though GGA is now an effort to unlock some of the barriers and address some of the problems that come on the way. And it operates in such a way that the members of the alliance can propose projects and initiatives when they have identified such barriers or problems, either working in a country or working with a project. And this kind of an initiative to work on that particular case is then presented to the membership, who then evaluates if there are members who want to contribute to solving this problem. And of course, in terms of evaluating the prospects to which the alliance will take into the program, the greatest needs and priorities will then be considered. The action plan will be finalized now during this spring, and it will be possibly then accepted during the council meeting of IRENA in the end of May or early June. And we hope and look forward that the alliance would be in operation second half of this year. So thank you. There is still a few photos about the mapping exercise that we have started. It's work in progress. Thank you.
Terrific. Thank you so much. That was a very, very helpful overview in terms of the role of IRENA and the process moving forward with regard to geothermal and the involvement of countries in Africa, South America, et cetera. I think that is so, so important and exciting. So we look forward to seeing this new plan come out, hopefully in May, you were saying. So we are now going to turn to our next speaker, to Dr. Meseret Zemedkun, who has been with with UNEP, the United Nations Environment Program, since 2011, where she is the program manager of the African Rift Geothermal Development Facility. And as part of this work, and I should say that she also is a geophysicist, she has worked for also more than 20 years in the Geological Survey of Ethiopia, where she was responsible for three operating divisions, including engineering geology, geothermal, and hydrogeology. So she has done many, many projects working as an international geothermal consultant, working with many, many different companies, with many different associations and governments. It is our pleasure to welcome you here today.
Thank you very much, Madam Chairperson, for the nice introduction. And good afternoon, all. It is really my pleasure and honored to be here with you all, and just to share with you my experience in geothermal development in Africa, and also the role of my organization, UNEP, in the development of this geothermal resource in the region, in African region. And I would like really to extend my appreciation to the Geothermal Energy Association for inviting UNEP to be part of this panel and to share our knowledge and experience on this. So as you see that we will mostly talk on development of geothermal resource in Africa, and particularly on the key issues, the context in Africa, and the renewable energy and its opportunities for development, because geothermal is one of the major renewable energy that really contributes to the socio-economic development in my continent, and the role of UNEP in this energy development, specifically in Africa, and give you an overview what the UNEP African Rift Development Facility Program is doing in collaboration with the member countries and partners as well. The key issues now is, as you know, Africa is really undergoing a sustained period of economic growth. And also it is transformation. But it is dramatic population growth, and economies are also developing and diversifying. This really entails a high energy demand for meeting that objective of diversifying this economic growth. So the next 20 years, we'll see Africa reaping extensive benefits from global developments in the field of clean energy investment specifically. So opportunities exist for Africa to realize its economic and social development, but that will be by increasing the energy, the modern energy access in this continent. So I think the Africans now have a slogan, a prosperous Africa based on inclusive growth and sustainable development that really requires a sustainable energy development. So the current scenario, what we have in Africa is, though we have 20 years from now and also back, if we see that still we have an energy access gap, big access gap, particularly when you see in the sub-Saharan Africa. And the business as usual scenario is not going to work because there is a dramatic increase of a demand of energy, so we have to really work in a different issue and also trained. The investment gap we have, according to the African Union Commission of the Program for Infrastructure Development in Africa, really indicates that there is 6.3% of growth of economy and also the population growth that really requires a high demand of energy. So you can see that there is a big access gap in investment of this energy. So, but however, as we heard always, that renewable energy Africa is endowed with a huge renewable energy potential, both even non-renewable and renewable as well. And as you see, the geothermal, Africa possesses a remarkable geothermal potential, which really reaches more than 20 gigawatt. And also it has abundant solar, wind, biomass, and other resources of energy. But Africa has now a big goal of its developing objective to accelerate the growth of markets of renewable energy and energy efficiency. And also with the context of poverty eradication or elimination, economic growth and sustainable development, there is a contribution of renewable energy. So the opportunity for energy development in Africa, including geothermal, is instead of talking about challenges, it's better to tell you what are the really ample opportunities now in Africa is a variety of renewable energy resources, wind, solar, hydro, biomass, geothermal, and so on and so forth. And also the increased national and regional policy commitment. Now, the governments of the African countries are really committed and developed their strategy towards the clean energy development. That is really a very good opportunity. And the climate-related financing we have by ADB, the scaling up of renewable energy program, the new initiative of the US Power Africa, the GCF, the green climate finance, the clean investment, the climate investment finance, emerging financiers also on renewable energy, and the various global, continental, and regional energy program projects. You have heard from the deputy director of IRENA that there are new projects coming up. So now in Africa, this is the UN initiative of the Sustainable Energy for All, and the Global Geothermal Development Plan by the World Bank of ISMAP, in the Program for Infrastructure Development in Africa, the new launched during COP21, the African Renewable Energy Initiative, where UNEP has played an important role and with big investment, that is really also an opportunity. The African Rift Geothermal Development Program, what we have in the African Union Commission, German Development Bank of the Geothermal Risk Mitigation Facility. These are ample opportunities for development of this geothermal. So now just talking about then, what is the role of UNEP in these issues? Why energy? Why the clean energy? As you all know, UNEP is one of the UN agencies responsible for environmental matters that is mostly concerned with environmental assessments, analysis, and guidelines. So that is mostly towards, you know, in countries to manage the environment for their sustainable development goals. So UNEP has various thematic areas, about seven. I don't want to go in detail, but the energy part is in its thematic areas of the climate change in the mitigation. And Africa, you know, the UNEP has different kinds of the regional offices. The African Reef Geothermal Development Program is from the regional office for Africa based in Kenya. But we have different regional offices, including the regional office of North America here in Washington, D.C. So these are where we are really implementing different thematic areas, including the energy and climate change. So the energy branch is leading this climate change mitigation, which is based in Paris. So actually, the main areas of this mitigation is to secure the transition into low emission development pathways. That is to mitigate the greenhouse gas emissions, where we are also focusing on the geothermal energy project development. The others are adaptation, Reid, and also the science and outreach, but this is mostly that is focusing in terms of the energy part. So UNEP's contribution, including in this regional geothermal development, is mostly providing sound policy advice. We catalyze public and private investments for clean energy development and stimulate the uptake of low greenhouse gas emissions and also the climate-friendly technologies. I will give you an example later on how we just really contribute in the ARGeo program in Africa. So the engagement, mostly we are engaged in the sustainable energy for all, particularly in the energy efficiency part. And also we help the countries on climate change negotiations. And also now UNEP is really playing a role on the Agenda 2030. In the Agenda 2030 on the Sustainable Development Goals adopted in September 2015, where we all, the UN agencies and also countries, are really working to really eradicate poverty and also for sustainable development in each country. And the other is the launch of the African Renewable Energy Initiative. So we just launched in Africa also the Sustainable Energy for All Initiative. Now, in terms of the sustainable development goals, as you see, an effective integration of the environmental sustainability in sustainable development goals is UNEP what is playing a role, particularly in its capacity to produce science-based products, including assessment of reports and scientific and technical guidelines. So in this case, the development of renewable energy resource in general and geothermal resource in particular is a critical mass of addressing the prevailing energy poverty in Africa. These are the main issues that really related to energy, the different parts of the sustainable development goals where UNEP is also working in this area. So the energy-related projects, you know, we have a number of renewable energy projects, but I will focus mostly on the main, the GEF-funded regional African Reef Geothermal Development Program that is implementing by UNEP. So this program, as you see, you can see that we just are involved from exploration and we catalyze investment and try to really bring the public and private investments to fast track the development of geothermal energy resource. So as you see here, you have heard, the East Africa Rift System is really a major tectonic structures of the Earth where it possesses a remarkable geothermal potential, where it has a different volcanic centers that are responsible for production of this geothermal energy resource. So the East Africa Rift System, it extends here from down the Dead Sea down to Mozambique, which is about 6,500 kilometers, where we have a number of Eastern African countries and the Western branch like Djibouti, Eritrea, Ethiopia, Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, Burundi, Comoros, and here we have also Zambia, Malawi, and Mozambique. That is where we are focusing even beyond the GEF-funded project. And as you see, this East Africa Rift System endowed a huge geothermal resource that exceeds greater than 220,000 megawatts. But if you see today, we have only a 630 megawatts that is being generated, maybe more than 95% by Kenya, which is followed by Ethiopia. And other, the East African countries, which I've called just a while ago, none of them have reached at that level. But the governments are really committed, and they want to develop their geothermal resources. They are really trying to revise their energy policy to attract private investors and also developers. You will hear tomorrow, if you come to the panel, the rise of East African Rift Valley geothermal development, and from some countries, including the UNEP program. So in this case, our response and the challenge we have is, and this is the upfront cost, and particularly the risks associated with resource exploration. So in that case, the main response we have is the UNEP ARGeo program, which is really tries to encourage both private and public developers by just trying to minimize the risk associated with resource exploration and development. Here I would like to recognize the presence of our Deputy Director of the Regional Office for Africa, Ms. Fatu. She's also attending, you know, just with me here from UNEP. Yeah. So in this case, the ARGeo provides just fast and targeted demand driven to the challenge of these East African countries to really accelerate this untapped and huge geothermal energy resource in the continent. So it brings solution to really mitigate the risk associated with resource exploration. And we'll see how. Just to brief, to tell you, the GEF-funded ARGeo target countries are six. They are Eritrea, Ethiopia, Kenya, Rwanda, Tanzania, and Uganda. But apart from that, we have other seven additional countries where they are really using our platform in terms of regional networking, capacity building, and policy advice as well. So our mostly the support activities are the technical assistance for surface studies, that is mostly to mitigate the risk associated with this resource exploration, the policy advice to develop a clear and coherent geothermal policy and institutional framework, and also the regional networking information systems where we are able to develop the African geothermal inventory database for the 13 countries, which is available for all public and private developers, and they can get any kind of information related to geothermal in those regions. The other is awareness creation. We just try to go to talk to the high-level decision makers, prime ministers, ministers, and presidents, to really create awareness the use of geothermal and also to diversify their energy resources. And the capacity building scheme is also very important now, where UNEP is really leading and providing a matured institutional support in setting up of the African Rift Geothermal Center of Excellence with partners. So we have different partners. We have the African Union Commission, the Icelandic Development Agency, United Nations University, US Power Africa, IRENA, and many other agents we have. So far, you know, we have tried, just as I said, we tried to create awareness. You can see that even the late Prime Minister of Ethiopia, we were trying to take them to Kenya to show them how geothermal really can contribute to the development of their energy resource. That's how we ended up having in Ethiopia the first IPP of geothermal through Reykjavik Geothermal for 1,000 megawatt with the investment of about $4 billion. So these are the different ministers and what we have, where UNEP is really playing a catalytic role for the policy and other issues. And also we create countries' ownership with this. They are the leaders and also the ones who committed to implement. UNEP is there only to serve their countries. So I think we can just briefly just say that in terms of the projects, what we have done, particularly associated with risks to mitigate the risk. The first two projects are, one is in Kenya. I think most of you are familiar. I can see that who are board of even directors of the Kenyan Geothermal Development Company and KenGen. Here is, we have, we tried to help the Geothermal Development Company to study the Silali project and also to mitigate the risk and identify the locate target sites for deep drilling. The other is in Ethiopia, in Tandaho, Dupti Erobera. We just managed to produce this project pipeline and submit it to the African Union Commission Geothermal Risk Mitigation Facility, where we created an operational linkage that really catalyzed investments. Now, at this stage, these two projects are now just legitimate for the German Development Bank and also for the French Development Agency to go for their drilling. They are in preparation for drilling after getting the results from UNEP. The other four projects now going on, it's not only Kenya and Ethiopia. Many people, when they talk about the East African Rift System, they talk about only Kenya and Ethiopia. But now we are in a different scenario. There are a number of countries where you can see now, Eritrea, Uganda, Tanzania, and Rwanda, they really want to go for the development of their resource to confirm that whether they have this resource or not. So UNEP has really running this four projects in parallel. Now we are implementing it. This is mainly to catalyze investment for geothermal development. This is the mainly the African Rift Geothermal Database, what we have created, which is online. The Icelandic Development Agency, this is the Icelandic Deputy Foreign Minister that launched this database. The other is UNEP is really actively playing a role in capacity building, particularly through its biennial ARGeo conferences. And I know most of you have been to these conferences. It is 2 years, every 2 years, we just create this platform for capacity building and networking as well. And also we prepared capacity buildings in with United Nations universities and also with US Power Africa, with East African Geothermal Program, and also with the German Institute and also the Icelandic development projects. This is demand driven and we do it only when countries requested for it. The other, what we are currently doing is now the African Geothermal Center of Excellence, which is, I think, for geothermal that is in Africa, is the sustainability will come when we just set up this kind of center of excellence in order to have to really create a number of skilled manpower that will be hand in hand to this geothermal development. So the last slide, what we have is the role that UNEP is playing, as you see here, is now this is the scenario, the different stages where we have for geothermal development scenario. This is the early stage where probably most of the greenfield by the public entity that has to be done, where UNEP is playing role in identify projects. We have the risk mitigation facility here created by the African Union. We developed these projects and it can be done. And then we need to bring, you know, the private developers, we need a good transactional advisors, where the US Power Africa is really playing an important role in the region in this catalytic role. So our plan is now, we think the country is now to develop 500 to 1,000 megawatt by 2030. This is where UNEP is playing an important role. Our conclusion is that in Africa, the sustainable development will be achieved by having only the sustainable energy, specifically also the geothermal energy. So the private sector participation is crucial. That's what we need. And also the partnership and also is a very important role. And you can see in terms of strategy, now countries have developed their policy and have already ready for this investment. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you very much. And we will now turn to our next presenter, who is Benjamin Matek, who is the Research Projects Manager for the Geothermal Energy Association, where he is really responsible for staying on top of the status of geothermal domestically as well as internationally, and provides a lot of thoughtful documentation and research and analysis with regard to policy issues, the status of the industry, and whatever the association and its members feel is needed with regard to research and white papers. Thank you.
Thank you for that nice introduction. Oh, do I have to change it down here? No. Oh, I see. Thank you. Yep. Sorry for that. Okay. So, give you a little brief of who I am. We are the Geothermal Energy Association. We're a trade association of 150 different geothermal power companies who work all over the world. As you can see from this graph, this is a graph of the different places that our companies are working. And also on that is a nice picture, if you're wondering where are the currently identified geothermal projects globally. This is a nice picture of that as well. A lot of European countries, you can see the South Pacific, Australia, South America is just beginning to look at geothermal. North America, we've had plants since the 70s. A lot of people don't know that. And Canada is 60s, sorry, 60s, Anne. Thanks, Anne. I wasn't alive then, so.
I was born.
But yeah, so there we go. And just quickly what I'm going to do, I think this will be a nice transition because we just learned about the international market. I'm going to briefly cover the international market, and then I'm going to end with talking about the U.S., and then I think Doug and Jack will talk a little bit about the U.S. as well. And then if you didn't know what a geothermal power plant looks like, because a lot of people don't, you might drive by them all the time if you're driving out west and not even realize. That is a picture of what one would look like up close down at the bottom.
Idaho.
Oh, and that's Doug's plant. That's why he's likely looking at me weirdly. That is the U.S. Geothermal's plant in
Idaho.
Idaho, okay. Thanks for letting us use that picture. So here is the forecast we've started doing for a few years now for the geothermal sector. People often ask us, where is the sector going? The blue line is where we've been. The dotted blue line is what we forecast we did 3 or 4 years ago. So you can see we've already exceeded our forecast, which is some heating up news, good exciting news. The top green line is announced projects. So that's projects where a company or a company or a country or a government agency, someone who's trying to build a power plant, a utility, said we want to build a plant by this and this date that is geothermal energy powered. The bottom line is plants that have already started construction, so that's plants where there's already holes in the ground and they've done flow tests and they know that there's power coming out of the ground. And that's why it sort of levels off, because it takes 17 to 34 months to build a power plant, so normally those don't get announced as quickly. So 18.3 gigawatts, a little over 18 by the early 2020s, and 14, almost 15 gigawatts of plants under construction right now. So you learned a little bit about Global Geothermal Alliance in the earlier presentations, which is working with IRENA and the UN and a bunch of other international bodies. That is the blue line. That is the goal they want to identify. They want to increase geothermal 6 times by the 2030s. You've announced geothermal goals in the green at the bottom. That is, countries have set targets, or utilities, or regions, or states, or counties globally have set targets, and that is what they have said they want to build by such and such date. And the blue line is what we call geothermal potential. I hope no geologists in the room get mad at me for how I'm about to describe this, but geothermal potential is identified projects or resources globally, and that right now equals about 200 gigawatts. And that is just traditional hydrothermal resources. That is not EGS, that is not co-production, that is not direct use. I mean, those would multiply that would raise that dotted striped area probably by 5, 6, 7, 8, if not more times. And so that's just give you a picture of what the industry needs to do to sort of meet that IRENA goal or GGA goal and what can be done in the future with, we're talking about just one sort of sub, like the most mainstream sort of sector of the geothermal industry. One of the misconceptions about geothermal is that we are an old, ancient technology. Yes, it was true that the first geothermal plant was built about 100 years ago, but so was the first solar plant, so was the first wind plant. If you go on, you know, pull out your phone and look on Wikipedia right now, you can see right now sort of a couple things from this chart, the different mainstream technologies of geothermal, but you can also see sort of some technological evolution in the industry. That light green at the top line is the expansion of the binary turbine, which enabled the industry to build projects on lower temperature fields that we weren't able to do 20 years ago. That you can see that now has grown to be about 16% of the market. And we've just sort of started exploring those types of resources in the US. There's tons of systems that haven't even been built on yet that are that could build host those types of power plants. You see triple flash, which is a new idea of putting more turbines on a single field that just started being done a few years ago. And that's the purplish line there in the middle. You have the evolution of single flash, double flash, and dry steam, which is sort of the oldest style of plant. That is the plant, the geysers out in California right now is a lot of dry steam type turbines. If you were wondering, and now sort of transitioning to the US, if you're wondering where are these plants in the US, here's a nice picture. This is a map of EGS resources, but I also picked it because it has traditional hydrothermal plants on it as well. The black dots are identified traditional hydrothermal systems. So that's where water already exists in the ground, and we're going to pull it up and use that energy to make a power plant. The rest of the color coding is EGS. One, I think the biggest takeaway I would encourage everyone to realize from this is that there's some type of geothermal everywhere. There's heat everywhere in the United States. So every congressional district, every county, every state, you could do some type of geothermal project. If that's a direct use system where you're running a greenhouse, if that is a power plant because you're in California and you have the best geology for building a power plant, if that is, I don't know why Alaska or Hawaii aren't color coded, but Hawaii is a volcanic island. It definitely has geothermal power. I mean, there's a guy in Idaho who farms alligators with geothermal direct use heating systems. So it is a, you know, don't think this is a West Coast technology. It's an everywhere technology. Here is sort of a quick history of the geothermal industry and the US. Right now, we are about 3.6, 3.7 gigawatts of power. It depends sort of on the, if you want to talk about net or nameplate, what the total potential of a specific turbine is. But you have sort of PERPA, which a huge expansion of the industry after PERPA was passed. You have an expansion after the PTC, ITC was passed in 2005, and a very popular program among some of the probably companies in this room was the GRED program. It was a small $2 million program that helped give grants to developers to build projects. Oh, 3 minutes left, real quick. You'll always see this chart at any geothermal conference you go to. This is geothermal. One of the barriers of geothermal is the high upfront risk. And you can see that on the left. The projects get less and less risky as they go on, so it's really hard to find investment. Even though it's not that expensive to start a project, the expense comes later when you're actually building it. And so that is why that the best types, some of the most popular types of policy incentives that work for geothermal are ones that help reduce that risk in the beginning of the project. Geothermal companies in the US love the ITC because they can take that cash and they can reinvest it in their next project. Projects, main point here is that projects that help reduce that upfront risk, incentives that help reduce that upfront risk are really popular. And one of the problems with geothermal in the US is we sort of had stops and starts of those types of incentives that have really hindered the industry to be able to grow on levels comparable with solar, our friends in solar or wind or biomass or hydropower. Here's one quick example. There's many more of California. California has built a system of very high asymmetrical incentives favoring solar over geothermal, and that's why there's that famous duck curve, which you might have heard about somewhere else in California. They have the Clean Power Plan gives a included solar. Geothermal is not included in there. There's a state tax credit rebate in California for solar. There's not one for geothermal. There's a property tax expense for solar in California. There's not one for geothermal. They get special rates for net metering. We had someone who's trying to build a small distributed use system for geothermal in California. He could not get a net metering price for it. and their special solar RECs. Quickly, people don't realize geysers has been built, was first built in the 60s. It's one of the oldest geothermal fields, and it could easily be expanded. There's shovel-ready geothermal projects in the Imperial Valley and up to over 2 gigawatts of potential power there that could be built in either using California or exported throughout the West. And then there's a few other locations like Northern California that have lots of power that could potentially be built. So that's all I have. Here's my email. Always welcome to shoot me an email if you have more questions. It's what I'm here for. Thanks for having me.
Thanks. That was a really good and very, very quick rundown of what the overall situation looks like on both the policy side as well as the resource side. So I think we just have a lot more work to do to get more and more of that information out, and also the whole host of technology applications that geothermal really can provide that I think so many people are really not aware of. So we're now going to hear from that person whose plant we saw, Doug Glaspey, who is a founder of U.S. Geothermal Inc., and he is also the president and COO of U.S. Geothermal. And the company was started in 2001, became public in 2003. And U.S. Geothermal has built, owns, and operates 3 binary cycle geothermal power plants in the West right now. And the good news is that they are currently developing a series of projects in the U.S., in other locations, as well as in Guatemala. Doug, welcome.
Good job. Thanks. Thank you, Carol. Welcome, everybody. Glad to have you here today. I'm also the current president of the Geothermal Energy Association, an honor that was bestowed recently. We are a public company, so I'll give our forward-looking statement. But we are, as Carol said, we're located in the western U.S. We're headquartered in Boise, Idaho, and we've been public since 2003. I have to learn how to use the clicker clearly. So we are western U.S. based, of course. We have a number of projects, but we've also stepped offshore into Guatemala. That was about 5 years ago. We have the 3 operating power plants. We have developed all those plants from scratch, basically, built, owned, and operate currently. And then we have a number of advanced and exploration level development projects. The geysers in Northern California is our most advanced project, followed by El Sabio down in Guatemala. I came up today to talk a little bit about comparing, I guess, between what's going on in the U.S. and what's going on, especially in emerging economies. Of course, in the United States, we have a flat or declining grid load. As a matter of fact, an article just came out yesterday from the U.S. Energy Information Agency. In 2015, the amount of power that was sold in the U.S. went down 1.1%. We've gone down 5 out of the last 8 years. Now, when I started in this business a mere 12 years ago, we were looking at 1.5% to 2% growth rates, and it looked like it was all sunshine going forward on selling electricity. As we've heard today in the developing nations, it's a growing load, an expanding grid. They're like the United States probably was at the turn of the century, in the 20s and 30s, when we had the REA and the government was out there building power lines, building dams, and getting power to every house in the country. In the U.S., because we have a long history, we have mostly smaller resources, and many of them are moderate temperature. We do still have a couple very large high-temperature resources that are standing by waiting for development. Again, offshore, mostly larger and higher temperature resources, so it's easier to build larger power plants. That makes the economics better. It's been mentioned earlier, in the U.S., our government incentives tend to be very short-term, and they're unreliable. They get extended for a year. Sometimes they're backwards for a year, or we get 1 week left in a year. Makes it very hard for an industry to plan and develop projects. We see, of course, in East Africa and places like the Philippines, lots of development is supported by the country itself. They spend money drilling resources. the World Bank's there, there's international funds. Everybody wants to put money into those areas to develop those resources. Permitting in the U.S. on federal lands is difficult and expensive. In the western U.S., where we do most of our work, we're looking at 60 to 70% of the landmass of many of these states, sometimes higher, is federal land. So we're forced to deal with federal permitting and NEPA. To give you an example, we have a drilling program. We drilled last year some temperature gradient wells. We designed and built those wells so we could re-enter them and drill them deeper if they were successful. We applied to drill two of those wells deeper 6 months ago. The well pad's there, the casing's in the ground, the roads are there. We're still waiting for the BLM to let us drill those wells another 1,000 feet deeper. It boggles my mind. But what happens is everything's done at the district level in the BLM. They have a high turnover rate of personnel, and they don't have the expertise. So every time somebody leaves an office and a new person comes in, they start all over again on your project. It makes it very difficult on these projects. We do see relatively fast permitting, I think, overseas, because again, the government wants that energy and they want renewable energy, most of all. Our government says we want renewable energy, but it doesn't translate down to the district level at the BLM, I can tell you that for sure. For the most part in the U.S., the exploration risk is borne by the developer. Ben mentioned we had the GRED program a few years ago where they cost-shared drilling with us. And that was very helpful for our developers like myself and other companies trying to build power projects because it reduced our risk. It's very hard to raise equity funds. If you've run into venture capital guys, they want 30% return on their investment. That's just not the geothermal business. We're selling electricity. There isn't that kind of margin. So it makes it hard to go out and raise money. In many cases in offshore countries, developing nations spend that money to do the drilling, or there's international funds that spend that money to do the drilling, and the developer just has to come in and build a power plant on an existing resource. We also in the U.S. have a plethora of low-cost energy options now. Natural gas has hit bottom. Solar's going crazy. We've got public companies putting solar panels on everybody's rooftops. It's just kind of a nutty place for renewable energy, but it's growing fast. In most developing nations, they don't have those options yet. So we have a lot of competition in the U.S., which is always good, of course. And then, as I say last, economics, economics, economics. As a company, we have to make a profit for our shareholders. So at some point in this whole process, after we drill dry holes, good wells, build power plants, sell electricity, we've got to be able to make a profit for our shareholders. Our country's goals, I think, have to be aligned. If we really want renewable energy, and I think the solar folks have had a bit of a problem in the permitting end. Of course, they clear much larger pieces of land than we do, but that's beside the point. Now, as we dry our tears, in the U.S., it's not all bad news. We have a great, well-developed transmission infrastructure, so I don't have to build hundreds of miles of transmission line to get to my project. We have one of the most experienced geothermal workforces and technical teams in the world. Those same people now are helping in East Africa to build out other people's geothermal projects. We have a great drilling industry. You've got to have a drilling industry with that support in order to successfully drill geothermal projects. If you need drill bits, if you need drill steel, whatever you need, it's got to be relatively close by or the cost of drilling goes through the roof. One of the big saviors in the U.S. has been the state renewable portfolio standards. It's states like California, Nevada really started it, I guess. We've got Oregon now that's gone to a 50% standard just like California. That creates market. Those utilities now are rethinking their goals. They have to go out and find renewable energy. As Ben mentioned, the duck curve, maybe they bought too much solar in the last few years and they don't know what to do with it during the day. Solar doesn't produce at night very well, so they have to start looking at folks like geothermal. The Department of Energy has been able to maintain the Geothermal Technologies Program and actually increase funding, not just to help us with the hydrothermal program, but to help with EGS, Engineered Geothermal Systems, which is a real great future shot for us. And of course, back to the federal incentive. The 30% ITC has been a real boon for our industry. But the fact of the matter is we need a five-year term. We don't need a one-year term. 1 year drives us crazy when we do economic models for a project that takes 5 to 7 years to build, and we only have a window we can go talk to our financial institutions and say, well, here's the price of our power if we have the ITC or if we have the PTC, but we've got to know what we're going to have in the future. And I'd urge everybody that works in congressional offices, either in this room or listening in, to give us some help. So last but not least, why geothermal? It's a baseload power source. It's a direct replacement for coal or nuclear. There's a lot of coal plants that are being shut down. The state of Oregon just mandated shutting down its coal plants. Nevada's done the same. California's done the same. You got to replace it with something. You can do it with natural gas, I guess. It doesn't require firming power like the intermittents. It doesn't require energy storage like the intermittents. Solar sounds really cheap until you want to turn your light switch on at 12 o'clock at night. Then you've either got to have storage or firming capacity, and that costs extra money. It provides grid stability. I'd hate to be a grid operator today, I have to tell you. I've sat and watched a power meter off a solar plant when a cloud went over. They can go from 100 megawatts to 0 megawatts in seconds. Now, grid operators are keeping us safe today, but that's getting harder and harder for them to do. It also has the highest job density of any renewable. Geothermal provides jobs. Some people don't care about that, but I can guarantee you that the county that you're in and the city that you're close to does care about jobs. And if you're worried about the environment, we have the smallest footprint and the lowest visual impact of any renewable technology, and we have minimal impact to wildlife. So to close, I'd like to say that we like geothermal. We think it's the best technology available, and I'd be happy to listen to anybody's questions here in a little bit. Thank you very much.
And I can see why you're the chairman of the association. Absolutely. So we now want to turn to Jack Thirolf, who is the Director of Regulatory Affairs for ENEL Green Power. And he has been with ENEL Green Power for the last several years since 2012. And before that, when we first met, he was with the Business Council for Sustainable Energy, so that he really brings a background in a lot of different renewable and efficiency technologies. And ENEL is in terms of Jack's work with ENEL, he is involved in terms of looking at regulatory affairs for both the United States and Canada at both the state or provincial level as well as at the federal level for North America. So we are glad to hear from you, Jack, about everything that ENEL is doing in this space.
Thank you very much for that introduction. Thank you to everybody for coming. It's really a pleasure and honor to be part of the group today. Let's see if I... That's definitely not the right button. Here we go. Thank you. And before I get going, I actually wanted to pick up on a remark from Ryan from Senator Reid's office as he welcomed us today. And that was a test of willpower. As a concept in the policy arena, and also for geothermal development. As you've heard from the first four speakers, I think you heard that geothermal is a fantastic resource, a fantastic technology, provides a lot of benefits to the grid, but it is a test of willpower. It takes tough, smart people to pull it off. I think that's also true as we've talked about some of the policy challenges that we've had. So I like that framing, a test of willpower. That's what the geothermal industry is about. So what I'm hoping to do today is tell you a little bit about who we are at ENEL Green Power, and then I think you'll hear me echo a few of the reflections on the U.S. market, on the international market, and then what unique attributes and policy are really needed to help drive geothermal development. Okay, let me tell you. And now, who are we and what do we do? ENEL is part of a very large, one of the world's largest electric utilities based in Rome, Italy, but active in more than 30 countries We have about 90 gigawatts of total generation, really all of the above. That includes nuclear, includes renewables, includes fossil fuels. Again, my responsibilities are just for the U.S. and Canada, but wanted to give you a framing about what we're doing and where we're doing it. And also to emphasize that our outlook, and I think this is helpful for geothermal and just for renewables more broadly, our parent company, the bulk of our new investment is going into renewable energy. That's not for our renewable, you know, subsidiary. That's for the entire company. It's a strategic shift and a recognition about how the world is different than it was 10 years ago, different than it was 5 years ago. We see renewables as the future. We see decarbonization as a must, not only for a kind of a social responsibility concept, but for the bottom line of the business. Renewables are where it's at, also with improving and strengthening the grid. And I think that has a strong tie also to as we're looking into developing markets where there's a need for infrastructure investment and there's a need for additional generation. This is our footprint here in the United States. We're unique in this market in that we work across four different technologies. We do run-of-river hydropower, we do solar, we do wind, we do geothermal. We're the largest owner of wind projects in the state of Kansas. I think we're number two in Oklahoma. We also have 150-year-old dams that were old mill sites in New England that following PURPA were repowered and turned into renewable energy facilities. And our geothermal footprint is all out west in Nevada and in Utah. When I joined the company in 2012, we were just getting up to a gigawatt. We're at 2.5 gigawatts today. So reflection of pretty rapid growth. Let me just say very briefly about ENEL's deep roots in the geothermal industry. The first geothermal resource to electric production was actually done in Tuscany, and that field and some of that infrastructure is still operating. So we'd like to say that geothermal is really a jewel in the crown for ENEL, an area where we take a lot of great pride. It's obviously aesthetically very pleasing in Tuscany, and there's actually a photo there of the ribbon cutting in 2013 for the Geothermal Museum in Tuscany. So when you're planning your next Italian vacation, please do remember the Museum of Geothermal Energy. I have not been, but I'm sure it is quite lovely.
It's a beautiful place.
It's a beautiful place. It absolutely is. And just to give you an example, I think of two things. One, that you know, it's a very established, workable technology. I'm going to talk about kind of cutting edge technology as part of that as well. And also just, it, you know, this is a resource that can work for a very long time, and it's something that's very important to our company. So here in the United States, we have three operating plants, two in Nevada, one in Utah. I will highlight the project far to your left, Stillwater, which is outside of Reno. And that is a project that's been first in the world two times over. In 2012, we integrated 26 megawatts photovoltaic next to the geothermal plant. The reason we did that is, as a binary air-cooled geothermal plant, we were seeing dips in production during the hottest times of the year and during the hottest parts of the day. Those also tend to be where electricity demand is the highest. Because the ambient air temperature is high, it was difficult to cool down the geothermal resource as it was coming up. And so the PV matched quite nicely, giving us a boost of production instead of a dip. And then just recently, and actually we're going to have a dedication for this project in the coming weeks, we're able to integrate a 2-megawatt concentrating solar power project directly into the geothermal project. So the first time that PV and geo was paired, also the first time that CSP was paired with geothermal. These are state-of-the-art power plants. There's a large amount of innovation in the industry. I wanted to kind of contrast this with that kind of 100 years of geothermal history in Italy to say that the industry is innovating and doing some pretty exciting things. We're obviously very proud of that project and like to point at it for that kind of map of all the countries where we're at, that this is probably the coolest project that's in that fleet, or at least that's what I like to tell our folks internally. We are also putting into service, projected for next year, the first geothermal project in South America. This is in Chile, a very unique project, at quite a high altitude, a demanding project from a construction standpoint. Should be at 48 megawatts of total capacity when finished. An exciting place for us, and part of our company's real focus on Latin America for geothermal and for all technologies. We think it has a lot of promise. Okay, so I think this will echo some of what you've heard before, but looking at the matchup between the market context and where we stand for policy. There is a distinction in the U.S. Renewables market. Geothermal is lagging behind wind and solar. There are some kind of structural reasons for that. We've heard a longer development timeline. So from your first dollar invested for a wind project compared to a geothermal project, you'll be selling electricity sooner for a wind project. That obviously makes a difference for financing. At times, we can have a higher levelized cost of energy, which can be an issue for us. There's a more confined resource. The wind blows in more places than where it's commercially feasible to develop a geothermal project. And on the policy side, state policies have generally not recognized or rewarded the baseload characteristic of geothermal power plants. We've heard federal tax policies, just by their timelines, have advantaged technologies that can start construction and finish quicker than can geothermal. There's a real mismatch and, in a way, an irony now that the longest certainty is provided for the technologies that, we do wind and solar too. So I don't mean this in a biased way. Can be done more quickly. So geothermal has the shortest outlook, but also the longest time from start of construction to being completed. And as we heard, also a large percentage of the resource is on federal lands, which can make it more difficult, more timely to develop. And just looking at some of the contrasts internationally, there is more growth outside the U.S. than here. There is still, geothermal's a player among the other renewable technologies, not dominating, but plays a bigger role. We are certainly seeing strong markets in East Africa and in Southeast Asia. We have a strong focus on Latin America. And just reflecting on some of the differences, higher price of electricity, generally in some of these developing markets where there isn't incredibly cheap natural gas available. Also growing electricity demand, as we heard, electricity consumption actually decreased last year compared to the previous year. That's obviously not the case for quickly developing economies. And we can also see places where government policy is more focused on the longer term, potentially more centralized. In the U.S., we have a more decentralized system, tend to be shorter-term in our outlook on energy policies and on forced or organized government procurement. So, the follow-up to, let's wipe away the tears. We think geothermal is a fantastic resource. It is unique for a variety of reasons. It's base load. There's no long-term fuel uncertainty. It's resilient production, zero to low emissions, zero to low water consumption for binary plants. It adds diversity in the power supply, which we think is certainly important. If there's a rush to one technology, it can unbalance the system. But because it is unique, it also needs thoughtful and unique treatment from policymakers. Long-term contracting is incredibly important. Making sure the incentives are paired up and equivalent for other technologies, supporting mitigation of drilling risk, efficient permitting programs. These are all areas where we think policy can better sync up with what geothermal has to offer. Thank you.
Thanks very much. We have a few minutes remaining for questions and to really further this whole discussion. So we welcome any questions or comments that you might have. In the back, okay. There is a microphone coming. If you could wait for it. Thank you very much.
Thanks. I wanted to actually ask about if you could dig a little deeper about incentives and maybe the equity markets a little bit. My co-authors and I recently finished a white paper on MLPs, REITs, and yield curves. Whichever speaker I guess would like to take this, but what your outlook is on, you know, whether Senator Kuhn's MLP Parity Act probably, unfortunately, won't be passed, but it, to have a tax advantage structure, in this case with MLPs for renewables, geothermal included, and then of course ENEL recently opted out of the yieldco in the U.S. Which is, as everyone, people will know, yieldcos have experienced significant market turmoil. But so yeah, so how, you know, just in terms of even in domestic context, but from a competitive advantage standpoint of how such projects play out internationally against other companies that are using tax advantage structures. And yeah, I don't know. It's a broad topic, but I think it's pretty important. So.
Okay, so the two guys at the end.
Thank you. And I might try to, just depending on the room, give a little bit of context and correct me if I'm mischaracterizing something, and then we'll try to answer kind of quickly and coherently. So part of the question is, how do you finance these projects? And for projects that have tax incentives, how are you potentially making those credits usable? How are you using them within the product finance? There has been, and just for context as well, I will not prognosticate on, you know, what legislation might get passed or not, but legislation introduced to open up master limited partnerships to renewables to encourage another level of investor into this market. MLPs are currently restricted to certain fossil fuel industries and has been cited as a driver for lower cost of capital for those industries. And as you referenced, ENEL Green Power doesn't have a yieldco. Yieldco is essentially another financing instrument where you're able to get more smaller investors involved and have a lower, again, the idea is to have a lower cost of capital for investors who are looking for steady long-term returns. Part of the reason why that works well for renewables is that these are very generally predictable projects. You know what you don't have a fuel cost input. You're generally selling under a long-term contract. It can become very, very predictable, and that can be attractive to a certain group of investors. Hopefully that's more or less framing it correctly. I will say for looking at our experience here, cost of capital is an important piece in looking at project economics, but it's not a panacea. It's one element. And if projects are viable for the kind of larger basket of reasons in terms of cost, in terms of the cost of electricity you're able to sell at, if those products are able to pencil out, renewables have tended to be a pretty, you know, capital-rich environment in the U.S. And so whether there's a constraint on just investment flowing into the market, I don't think we've seen that. We haven't seen that yet. That's not to say that the legislation isn't positive, but I don't know that that's, as we are listing kind of other policy priorities, top level for the geothermal industry.
No, I think Jack's absolutely right. We've talked about MLPs for a long time in the geothermal business. It would be another tool on our tool belt, I guess. I think more than anything, we'd like to get some parity because all renewables aren't treated the same. Clearly, wind led the charge with the PTC for a number of years, and it was always called the wind PTC for about the first 10 years until the Energy Policy Act of 2005, when it really was adopted for use by all renewables, including geothermal. So, and Ben mentioned in a number of cases where solar gets, you know, favorable tax treatment either on the state or federal level that geothermal or maybe wind now doesn't get. So more than anything, we'd like to have parity. Being able to plan long-term is a very big deal for us because our developments do take a long time. You know, typically wind, you have to collect wind data for a year for, let's say it's $100,000 and you can run out and build a wind project. Most solar data you can find on the internet. So you don't have to spend a lot of money to pick a place to build a solar facility. Geothermal is completely different. We have to spend millions of dollars and take several years to get to the point where we know we have a reservoir, that we can build a certain size power plant, then we have to get a PPA, and then we have to get financing. So the time frame is completely different. If we can just get some of the legislation to recognize that and put us on a level playing field, I think we'll do just fine.
Okay, great, thanks. Whoa, all right. So let's start over here. So we'll start here and then we'll work our way around, but just, right.
What are the most effective ways to develop geothermal energy in Latin America, and what typical roadblocks must be overcome?
Okay, I will.
Make sure you use your microphones, okay.
I'm trying to. Okay. Red is on. I appreciate that, and I'll go further and perhaps can follow up as well. Definitely appreciate the question. I will have to admit that my expertise is not in development in Latin America, and so may defer giving you an answer that would be less than complete or informed. But I will, you know, be happy to point you towards the resources that we've put out specifically on the project in Chile, how it's worked, and what our hopes are for the market going forward.
Yeah, I just make a quick comment. I think what our experience has been is not completely unlike going into a state in the United States that's never had a geothermal development before. Many of these countries have never had geothermal development, so they really don't know how to let you develop something from top to bottom, starting with your first phase of exploration through drilling. Even in Guatemala, for instance, where there are two operating geothermal power plants, they've been operating for 15 years or more, but those plants were drilled with international funds, so the well field was never developed by a private developer. They let out the power plant development, so the power plants were developed on that basis. They still have to figure out how they're going to give those rights to you, because remember, you have to own the right if you're going to finance something, so that's a big deal, not just finding it, but making sure that the concession you get is solid enough so you can go, even if it's to the World Bank, and say, I have a 30-year concession granted by the government, it's right here in writing, and you can rely on that concession so that when those guys lend you $150 or $200 million, they know that you're going to be able to carry out that project and have the concession in your possession. Now, there's always political risk. So we talk about political risk. Sometimes I see as much political risk in the U.S. as I do in countries overseas, because we don't know what the legislation is going to look like next year. So that's, I guess that would be my view on developing overseas. It's been interesting, though, and it's kind of fun.
Okay. Okay, go these two first and then to the woman in the back. Okay.
Ben, you mentioned the size of the EGS resource, and this is an emerging technology that really has big promise, not just to develop a lot more geothermal power, but also to mitigate some of that exploration risk Doug was talking about. In Germany and France and other EU countries, EGS projects are, in fact, developing because they do have incentives to get them off the ground. So, you know, I would just like to comment that some of these incentives that we might like to see for geothermal can really help us scale using EGS technology.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yep, that's a good point.
Great. Go ahead.
So I think it's fair to say that you didn't get some of the love that some of the other renewables got back in December. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to know what your thoughts were on why that happened, how this piece sort of didn't fit in with the rest of the puzzle that was being put together, and how you're thinking that a solution to that might work going forward. Is that possible sort of just here on the Hill on its own, or are you going to need a future administration that has this as a higher priority? Is it what's your strategy?
I'll go first this time.
Go for it.
I think we're taking a number of folks at their word, and it was just a mistake. It was an oversight. Geothermal should have been included, especially in the Section 48 fix. So we're expecting a fix. We'd like to see the Congress, the Senate, the House get together and fix it, because it's fair, and that would give us, for instance, Section 48 gives you 5 years now under the 30% ITC, and then it phases out. Well, that's what we've been asking for. Give us a long enough runway that we can go out and do projects, make plans, finance projects, and I think you'll see a lot of development in the U.S. if we can get that fix done. There are a number of folks working on it right now as we speak. We have people out doing congressional visits. I'll be doing the same thing this afternoon and tomorrow. So we have high hopes that they'll find a bill to attach that fix to. It should be a relatively simple fix. The senior members that agreed to this in the beginning all say that it was an oversight and can be fixed. So that's our hope.
Exactly. Just on timeline, I think, you know, the discussion has always been this year. It's a 2016 deadline, and so the hope would be, you know, this administration this year.
And this Congress is short on legislative days, so I know that it's a priority for a lot of people, and there is quite a lot of talk about it. Okay, there was another question right there. Mm-hmm.
When you're looking to site a geothermal facility, what are the geographic / geological / topographic features that make a good site?
I guess I'll start. You know, when we started the company, I came out of the mining business, which is another business where you spend a lot of money trying to find things. And I always said it was a treasure hunt. So finding geothermal projects, it's kind of the same way. It's kind of a treasure hunt. You go out and spend a lot of time looking, and on very rare occasions, you find that treasure that's a commercial geothermal resource. Having said that, and looking at geology and all the technologies used to try and find the right place to drill, we also look at something that's close to transmission, because transmission costs money. In the geothermal business, as an IPP, you have to pay for any transmission to get your project on the grid. So if you're 100 miles away from the grid or 10 miles away from the grid, it makes a big difference. You also want to look for market. As I said, it's economics. Where, in what state are they buying your power? Are they looking for renewable energy? And that's why the renewable portfolio standards were so important, because Nevada, California, now Oregon, and a number of other states in the U.S. now have RPSs. They want our power. They're essentially saying, we want renewable energy. So those things are very important. Of course, we've got a couple geologists that go out there and lick rocks, as we say, and they look at structural controls. And there's, of course, a lot of geologic requirements that have to be met to have something that's large enough. And without getting into the weeds, there are certain rock types that don't store enough energy, because at the end of the day, we're mining heat. You know, over tens of thousands of years, this resource has been built up by a heat source. It's a large body of hot water underground, and it's taken, tell me, Anne, 100,000 years, 200,000 years? Hundreds of thousands of years to create it, and we still have to find it. Sometimes there's a hot spring at the surface. That's the classical prospecting technique, I'd say. You find a hot springs, we're able to sample that water, do a chemical analysis, and get what's called a geothermometer calculation. So that water could be lukewarm at the surface, but its geothermometer might tell you that the source temperature was over 350 degrees Fahrenheit, for instance. Well, that's the kind of temperature you want to look for. You might go to another hot springs, and it could be boiling at the surface, 212 degrees. But the geothermometer might only be 220 degrees Fahrenheit. Well, that's not a very good temperature. So there's all kinds of prospecting techniques that we use, but we also look at proximity. If you listen to some of the presentations tomorrow, Guatemala, for instance, that project we have in Guatemala not only had some drilling on it previously, but it's also literally on the outskirts of Guatemala City, the largest group of people in Central America. It is the load center in Central America, and it's 12 kilometers away. Well, that's a great place to be when you're trying to sell electricity. So it really is a mix of a number of different aspects.
Great. Thank you. Go ahead.
In terms of East African, just to answer about the geographic distribution, yes, you know, the East Africa Rift System, it's one of the major tectonic structure where we have all the heat source. You can see it at the surface in terms of fumaroles, hot springs, and also steaming grounds. That's an indication. And as just he said, what we do now, for example, in UNEP, we are trying now to really assist countries, because by seeing only hot springs and fumaroles, it doesn't mean that you have the resource there. So we do an integrated geoscientific studies like geology. We do the structural geology, hydrogeology, because we want to know the recharge. And also the parameters for geothermal is the temperature, whether you have a high temperature or not. And the reservoir rock, that's the permeability you have, and also the recharge. So we do all the integrated geology, geochemistry, and after that, we just ask the geophysicists, you know, to send some current and to tell us where the low resistivity is. Low resistivity means where we have the reservoir rock. Though that's the kind of integrated geoscientific study what the UNEP, our geo program, try to assist countries really to show the occurrence of those resources. But it doesn't mean that, you know, for example, in East Africa Rift, we have Eastern and Western branch. In terms of the Western branch, we have hot springs, but we don't have the high temperature as we have the volcanic centers. So that has really also really requires a better study, which can be used also for direct use application, which is non-power, electricity, but we can use also the enhanced technology like the binary unit for effective use of this energy. So these are different geographical conditions that really contribute different source of geothermal, which can be used as power generation or for any other direct use application. In terms of incentives, I can say that also the other incentive we have in the Eastern Rift is the risk mitigation facility, in order to attract private developers by giving 14% of partial grant to the either to public or private developer of the cost of the well, in order to encourage private developers. This is one of the incentives we have. Then when it comes to developers, we just, you know, in Africa, they give, like any other countries, the tax holidays, and also just to really import just equipment and other things are just tax-free. Thank you.
Thank you. I know we are actually a little over time, and so if you can make your questions very, very fast, we'll take them, and then that will be it. Okay, go ahead to the back there. Back there first, okay.
A quick question for Mr. Oksanen. How will the Global Geothermal Alliance be funded? Can you tell us?
Easy question.
Yeah. It will be a little part of its operation and setting up, and coordination will be funded by the core budget of IRENA. But the core of the operations is that the members collect the initiatives, and they also then contribute to the actions. So there will be voluntary contributions by the member countries, and maybe by private entities if there is a commercial interest to solve some of these barrier problems, project by project.
Okay, thank you. And you had
Meseret? Oh, sorry. Cool. What role do communities play in implementing geothermal projects in Africa, and how do the plans benefit the locals?
In terms of the local communities, that is the member countries, normally now they develop policy and legislation and institutional framework just to attract investment. But the government is now also trying to do the green field, to do exploration in order to attract the private investment, because none of the private developers will go there when the risk is there and the resource is not identified. So they are really trying to get a different financing scheme, even the governments. And they do the exploration in the earlier stage with the different support programs like we are doing, the UNEP and others, and try to bring the developers at a stage of exploration drilling. And in some cases, for example, in Kenya, they really want to go further to really do also the production drilling and attract private investments. Because the main issue here is the PPA, because governments want really to give an affordable and reliable energy resource to its nation, where the private developers wants to go there, invest, and get profits. So the governments are really playing a role to marry these two things and to really accelerate the development of energy resources. And your second question, or
community?
Oh, yeah, thank you. Yeah, that's true. One is the, you know, the geothermal has versatile uses. One is for power generation, and the other is for direct use application. And as a whole, maybe I can use Kenya now, is they are really, if you go to Naivasha, for example, there's a lot of job creation, and also for the local communities, they build schools, and also the water wells and other things, they really get the benefit out of it apart from the power generation. And in terms of direct use application now in Africa, they are trying to really see to diversify and use geothermal power for agro-processing, aquaculture, and other things where really the community can get the maximum benefit out of it.
Because it enables so much other economic development as a result of having geothermal available in those different forms. Great. Well, I want to thank all of our panelists very, very much. And it also seems to me that we heard recurrently how important policy is, and that it just seems that the more that we can share those examples or policies that seem to be of the greatest help, best practices among all of our, whether it's states, different nations, internationally, here from the U.S., to help be able to expedite and accelerate the development of the technology and its implementation, we will all be better off. So I want to thank you all very, very much for coming, and look forward to seeing everyone at the showcase tomorrow. So thank you very, very much. Perfect.